aren't you glad that God has strength like no other?
Amen.
That reaches down to me, and that lifts me up whenever I am at my lowest, that I can be confident of the fact that God is always there. Oftentimes people will love on you when you're at your best, but the God you serve loves on you even when you are at your worst. Even when you have done the unthinkable or the unimaginable, God still loves you the best way that he can. So we thank God for his mercy and his abundant grace. We thank God for all that he has done and all that he will do. And we thank God just for being God. And I wish that if there were two or three people in here who are grateful that you serve a living God, and you just say amen. Buddha is dead, Confucius is dead, Muhammad is dead, but Jesus is alive.
Yes.
The fact that Jesus is alive, that should just bring springs of joy within your soul and to let you rejoice that you serve a living God.
Yes.
Him says he walks with me and he talks with me along life's narrow way. Y'all don't sing hymns no more, y'all don't remember those hymns. But we know that our God is present. He's a shelter in the time of storm. Y'all remember that hymn? That's a good hymn too. All hail the power of Jesus' name. The angels prostrate fall. You know that hymn, praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King who reigns forever. You know about those hymns. What about pass me not, O gentle Savior? Hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. Wait, what's going on? I thought y'all could finish them hymns with me. Tis so sweet, Jesus, just to take him at his word. Amen. Praise the Lord. I think we probably just need a whole day of just hymns. Just a whole day, just hymns. New stuff today, that's not even in my notes. I'm just talking right now. New stuff today, that stuff will just keep you going for about a few weeks until another album comes out. But you bust out an old hymn. You bust out Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound. And saved a wretch like me. I once was what? But now I was. But now I. Oh, that's some good music right there. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. Come on, church. Amen. But we thank God for the praise team. Amen. Strength like no other. You are my strength. Anyhow, let's get right into the Word of God. The hour is now struck 12 p.m., and I'm going to be in your face and out of your face in a heartbeat. Amen? And so let's go to the book of Acts 19, verses 11 through 17. Acts chapter 19, verses 11 through 17. You can say amen when you have it. Say, help me, Jesus, if you still look it. There's a few of you. Acts chapter 19, verse 11 through 17. It's a familiar passage from which we hope to draw some fresh water from. And it is on your screen. It is on your screens, on the screens. Amen. And so my version is a little bit different, but you'll be able to follow along. The Bible says God did extraordinary miracles through Paul, so that when the handkerchiefs or aprons that had touched his skin were brought to the sick, their diseases left them, and the evil spirits came out of them. Then some itinerant Jewish exorcists tried to use the name of the Lord Jesus over those who had evil spirits, saying, I adjure you by the name of Jesus whom Paul proclaims. Seven sons of Jewish high priest named Sceva were doing this. But the evil spirit said to them in reply, Jesus I know, Paul I know, but who are you? The man with the evil spirit leaped on them, mastered them all, and so overpowered them that they fled out of the house naked and wounded. When this became known to all the residents of Ephesus, both Jews and Greeks, everyone was awestruck, and the name of the Lord Jesus was praised. I want to put a tag on this text and simply entitle it, When You Have Religion with No Jesus. I got a more contemporary title as well, and I want you to indulge with me right now. Say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
Gang, recognize gang.
Gang, recognize gang.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your mercy and your grace. Be with me now, Lord, as we talk to you and through, as you talk through me. Hide me behind your cross. May your words be lifted up. In this we pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. I've learned this wonderful saying, that if you keep it real, fake people can't be around you. In a real sense, if you find yourself constantly dealing with fake people, then that may mean that you are the common denominator. Real people attract real people. There's nothing worse than a Christian chameleon. We all know that chameleons are one of the very few animals who can change their skin to adapt and assimilate in different situations. See, if a chameleon is on a leaf, then he turns green. If the chameleon is in the woods, then he will turn brown. If the chameleon, it's been said that the chameleon can go through a pattern of combinations from pink, blue, red, orange, green, black, brown, light blue, yellow, turquoise, and even purple. No matter what the environment, the chameleon adapts and assimilates to whatever it is around. And there is no doubt in my mind that you can sit down right now and you can think about a few Christian chameleons in your life. And they act one way in front of you, but act totally different when they are with somebody else. They say one thing to you, but totally different thing about you. Isn't there a song that goes something like that, describes Christian chameleons? I know y'all holy, so y'all probably want to know what the song was, something like this. They smile in your face, all the while they want to take your place, the backstabbers. Y'all holy, y'all don't know about that song. But that, it was a song that described that. You see, y'all not feeling this, but this is what the Bible says. The Bible says in Proverbs 16:28, that it reminds us that a troublemaker plants a seeds of strife, and gossipers separate the best of friends. That's that all that they are, dissenters, distractors, and detractors, to try to take you off the beat and path. Because here's the irony of backstabbers. It is funny how they are nice to your face. It is hilarious how they talk about you behind your back. It is absolutely comical that they think that you are aware of they are up to no good. Plotting and scheming, conniving, trying to build little silos about how they gonna take you out, trying to use your weaknesses as an opportunity against you. Let me tell you this the truth. Let me tell you this right now, church. This ain't the first time you have been to the show. You have seen this before. You know the routine. You already know the outcome, because if your backstabbers could have taken you out, you would have been dead already. But the same narrative is that the same God that was keeping you back then is the same God that is keeping you right now. The same God that has kept you in the past is the same God that will keep you today. That if your haters could have taken you out, you would not be here right now, but God has had his hand upon you. Matter of fact, you know my motto. You need people like that in your life. You need enemies and haters. You need to have people like that, because if you don't have them, then who is God going to prepare a table for you in the front of your enemies? Who is God going to use to make your footstool? Because Psalm 37 verse 1 says, do not fret because of those who are evil, or be envious of those who do wrong. For like the grass, they will soon wither. Like green plants, they will soon die away. But trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and enjoy safe pasture. Take delight in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust in him, and he will do this. And then in verse 6 it says this: he will make your righteous reward shine like the dawn, your vindication like the noonday. And I like that, because the text says your vindication will be like the noonday sun. In other words, everybody will see that you have fought the good fight, that you have kept the faith, that you did not stoop to their level of immaturity, but instead you rose up in the midst of adversity. Because what is vindication? It simply means it is clear that someone of blame or suspicion. And so what God says, I'm going to vindicate you, I'm going to clean your record, I'm going to write your slate, and I'm going to make sure that you are justified, warranty, substantiated, ratified, authenticated, verified, confirmed, corroborate, proved, defend, and you are supported, because you serve a living God. Because I need you to know, Lord, that I need you to vindicate me. Because if God, you don't vindicate me, I might just go back to my pre-converted days. Somebody here can testify, because you weren't in church all your life, and you know and understand that there are some people that you need God to take care of, because they can take you back to the womb you were before you met Jesus Christ. Some of y'all thinking about, y'all know that y'all weren't always coming to church on a Saturday morning, that you weren't thinking about coming to church on Friday night. And there are some people who can take you back to who you were BC, before Christ, because all of the poking and the bothering that they are doing to you. You weren't wearing fancy clothes all your days and long dresses and big hats. You know somebody in here can testify that I'm glad God is working in my life, because if this was a few years ago, there would be some furniture moving up in here right now, because I could go back to what I was used to be. I know if they keep talking to me the way they are talking to me, I will tell them how to get there and show them the fastest route and open up a can of you know what, but the love of Christ constraineth me. Somebody can testify. You know you ain't leave them days too far behind. And if anybody who could testify, you may not do it anymore, but you have not forgotten how to do it if you need to do it someday. Because you got some demons that you work with, you got some enemies that are sitting next to you, you got some people that you gotta deal with, but you know that God has been keeping me. Yeah. I said that, no, Holy, don't push me, cause I'm close to the edge. I'm trying not to lose my head. When you make them mad, this is my stuff. You already know something bad about to happen. Because when you get angry, you're supposed to have a serious face. But I know one thing, that whenever somebody, I'm going to give you a word of advice, if somebody starts laughing when they are angry, and then they start clapping their hands, and they start making a fist, then you better say, all right, you know what, it's been nice talking to you. I'm going to see you later. I'm going to go about my business. When they start laughing, you know very well and good that you wasn't always saved all your life. And if somebody pushes the right button or the wrong button, we could go back to BC, before Christ, before you met Jesus Christ, and you'll be glad to show them how to get to where they need to go and speak in a colorful unknown tongue, or for some to know the same tongue that you use the word that was just bright and beautiful. But we know and understand that God is the one that keeps us. So here it goes from the text. It says right here that the text says that God did extraordinary miracles through Paul, so that when the handkerchiefs and aprons that he touched the skin were brought to the sick, that their diseases left them and the evil spirits came out of them. Paul had what is known as a walking faith with God, that the powers extended to the garments that were on him, that the miracle was not outside of the ordinary, since it reminds us of the same power that Jesus had. When the woman with the issue of blood had walked up to Jesus, we are told that she stretched out and grabbed the hem of his garment, and immediately her blood dried up and she was made whole. That Jesus had more healing in the hem of his garment than Tylenol, aspirin, Bayer, Charleston Methodist, and Baylor Hospital has all together. That in the midst of Jesus walking, he did a drive-by healing and the woman was made whole in his garment. And so here we don't see anything different, that Paul's garments had such anointing on them that people were healed if they would just lay on their skin. Because in antiquity, it was also known that they would put oil and healing attributes on cloths, and they would put them on people in order to make them whole. But God used Paul in such a mighty way because of his walking power with Jesus Christ, that in so much the word got around that miracles were being worked through Paul by the power of God. And now the text informs us that there were some men, as the scripture says, itinerant Jews. And the Hebrew refers to them as vagabonds. And they were wanderers, fly-by-night men, who traveled among Ephesus performing magic. And the story tells us that Ephesus, that the city of Ephesus, was known for having a lot of magicians. And if these men didn't stand out, they were actually quite normal. But what they were doing was trying to ride the coattail of Paul's miracles so that they could gain popularity amongst themselves. They assumed that they could do the same. And the problem with these sons of Sceva is that they failed to acknowledge that it was not magic that Paul was using, that it was not tricks that Paul was using, but it was through the power of God that Paul was able to perform miracles.
See, I stand in front of you today to let you know that there is nothing that you can obtain outside of you that will bring healing and a difference in your life or in other people's life. Because I see it all the time. Buy this holy water. Buy this cloth. Sow this seed and watch God move. God does not move in that way. God moves when his people who are called by his name seek his face, humble themselves, and turn from their wicked ways. God moves when the people of God express and live a faith that will not be shaken by anything that goes against the norm. We didn't get here this far by your car. We didn't get this far by your golf game. We didn't get this far by your job. We didn't get this far by your account. We didn't get this far by what you do. But we got this far by faith and by faith alone, standing on the promises of God.
Amen.
So the word says that they try to cast out the demons in the name of Jesus of Paul. And that's where they utterly failed. In so much that they failed so bad that the Bible says that the demons questioned them, overpowered them, and they ran out the house naked. This is what happens when you have religion without Jesus. Because religion without Jesus is a farce. It is a show, it is a display, but it does not create real change. It is people who have religion and know Jesus occupy their people who have religion and know Jesus occupy their time with trying to pull others down. People who have religion and know Jesus, that they spend more time talking about other people instead of praying for other people. People with religion and know Jesus will spend more time talking about what people have done to them instead of figuring out what they can do to help other people. When you have religion without Jesus, you are what Paul refers to as a tinkling cymbal and a sounding brass, that you are just making noise. Because religion without Jesus is simply man trying to reach out to God by doing something that he thinks will please God. And they say this: if I could do enough, if I could say enough, if I could pray enough, if I could give enough, if I could sacrifice enough, perhaps God will show me more favor. Perhaps God will bless me more. Or perhaps I'll do all these things. My life should be better than yours, and I could do a better job than you. Because religion without Jesus becomes a sport for fools, just trying to outdo each other. Religion should never trump relationship, for it is relationship that should define and dictate your religion. Because if your religion does not encourage ways to build better relationships with your family, community, and humanity, then it is righteousness by works. You are not a Christian, you are just religious. And that impresses people in the pews and not God. And every day I pray, Lord, deliver me from religious people. Deliver me from people that always complain and always got a problem. Deliver me from unhappy, miserable, hate their own lives, don't got it all together, always pointing out your weakness, need to focus on your own family. Religious people who trying to control my life. But give me people who are lovers of Jesus. Give me people who understand that I am only as good as my neighbor. Surround me, God, with not religious people, but with people who have a relationship with you, who want to be drawn closer to you, and who testify of your goodness. That's the people that I want to know. Because religious people, all they care about is how they look. Religious people just care about how they can make themselves look better than other religious people, and they figure that since I'm doing this and I'm doing that, then I must be holier, and I've come here sent here by God to be the religious police to make sure that we put everybody back in their pews. God did not die and put you in charge. We all in the same boat. We all trying to get to the same place. And if you would focus on your life, then you would probably have a relationship instead of just having religion. Because I know and understand this, that you always know religious people. Religious people always compare themselves to other people. And so they always say this: well, at least I'm not doing that. And at least I'm not going there. And at least I'm not this kind of person. Because why? That's how they make themselves feel better. And I will give a perfect example of how that happens in reality. That I am a husband. I'm the husband of one woman. Amen. Somebody said, thank you, Jesus. One good looking woman. I may add to that as well. But as a husband, I do this. I would never ever compare myself to, say, for example, a husband husband like Ike Okotoke. I would not compare myself to Ike because perhaps Ike washes the dishes, perhaps Ike cleans the house, perhaps Ike cooks a meal, and perhaps Ike always does everything around the house while I'm not doing all those things that Ike is doing. But what I will do as a husband is I will compare myself to another husband who is not doing as much as I am. And so I'll find a husband who is sleeping on the couch all day. I'll find a husband who is not working. I'll find a husband who's not doing that stuff. Why? Because when I compare myself to him, I look better than he is, and it makes me validate myself as a better person. Most religious people always compare themselves to people who they think are not as religious as they are because it makes them feel better about who they are and what they do. And so what we have are religious competitions. We have religion Olympics inside the church from week to week. What are religion Olympics? Religion Olympics are this, that I know how to break down and quote the 2300 day prophecy and tell you that 0 = 1 in AD 57 when the king Arthur Burkius defeated the other general, and that this I know and all this other stuff. Religion Olympics is this, that I know how to quote from every book of the testimony of the law and the prophets of Jesus Christ that God gave to Ellen G. White. Why? Because pastor, you don't know as much as I know, and that's why I could question you, and that's why I could do that. But if you ever notice the thing about religious people, you always know this about conservative religious people. The reason why they are the way they are is because they are overcompensating for the sin in their lives and the sin in their past, and at the end of the day, they are some low down, dirty freaks doing things in between the sheets, but because they feel like I gotta be more holy. And so they figure I gotta be more holy, and so all they care about is who's doing who, and all they care about is your other business. They care about what you're doing because they know. And I've seen it before, and some of the most conservative religious people are the most hateful people I've ever met in my life. Most judgmental people I've ever met in my life. Most wicked people I've ever met in my life. I always condemn people to go to hell. You better watch out real quick, because you might be with them as well. Religious people. And so that's when you have religion without no Jesus, because religion without Jesus counts on works by righteousness. And so when the church begins to develop relationships, then we understand that that is what the whole Bible is about, building relationships.